Well, welcome everyone, or welcome back for those of you just joining us. My name is Judy Beck, and I'm with the Department of Physics here at the University of North Carolina, Asheville. Glad you could join us this afternoon. Let's point out our message up here. We're inviting all physics and astronomy type folks to meet and greet in Robinson 123 at 5 o'clock this afternoon. So please join us. And now I'd like to introduce our last speaker for this session, Robyn Lewis from the University of North Carolina, Asheville Department of Physics.
Thank you guys. Like Professor Beck said, I'm Robyn Lewis. My research project has been graphene growth on polyimide films via laser ablation. So the first question is, what is graphene? Right now, it's one of the most heavily researched products that there is. You guys have probably all heard of it. It's in the news fairly often. But we're going to talk a little bit more about what it actually is. So it's an allotrope of carbon, which really just means that it's a structural form of carbon. And because of carbon's bonding structure, it gives it the opportunity to form a lot of different allotropes. Diamond is one of them. Also just what's called amorphous carbon, but just general carbon. Graphite, which is found in your pencil leads. And for a while, these were the only allotropes that were known. So more recently, we have found that there are nanostructures that are allotropes of carbon, of which graphene is one. So graphene is just one single layer of carbon atoms that are bonded in a hexagonal lattice form. It's actually the first two-dimensional crystal that's ever been found. There have been a couple more since then, but this has been the first and probably the most groundbreaking. It is sort of the parent material of carbon fullerenes, carbon nanotubes, and graphite. Graphene does exist in monolayer and also p-layer forms, but what really sets that p-layer form apart from graphite is that each layer is electrically isolated, and that's really one of the key things with graphene. So in that hexagonal lattice, all the carbon atoms are bonded together covalently, which gives them a really strong bond. But there is an electron that's free in the third dimension. And it's that electron that really gives it a lot of its really cool properties. But how do we get just one layer of carbon? So this has kind of gone down in graphene lore. The University of Manchester in 2004, Andre Geim and Konstantin Novoselov were trying to make a graphite transistor. And so to get thinner and thinner layers of graphite, they used scotch tape, actually, to pull layers off of a block of graphite. And eventually, they realized that they were getting one single monolayer. I like to picture them sitting there in their lab with piles of sharpened pencils and scotch tape. But I think it was probably a little more scientific than that. They actually won the Nobel Prize for the first isolation of graphene in 2010. But so, what makes graphene so unique? It's just one layer of carbon, but it has all these really incredible properties that really weren't predicted. So it's extremely strong. It's 100 times the strength of steel, but it's also flexible. It can stretch 20% of its length without any damage to the material. It's the best thermal and the best electrical conductor that anyone's ever found. And in addition to that, it's 97% transparent. And so just to give you guys kind of an idea of what that means, glass is 92%. So this is almost entirely transparent. So the applications of graphene. I mean, you can imagine something that's lightweight, flexible, strong. Next generation electronics just kind of begs for this. That means anything like wearable technology, flexible and bendable, unbreakable touch screens. Also energy storage. It has the capacity, or it has the ability to make very small, high-capacity batteries that charge extremely quickly, also supercapacitors. In addition, the military is very interested in this right now, partly for its strength. So there was one study that was done just to sort of demonstrate the strength of a single sheet of graphene. They showed that if you took a piece of graphene, put a pencil down on top of it, you could set an elephant on top of this pencil, and it would not break the graphene.
Wow.
So obviously body armor is a big thing for the military technology. But in addition to that, they're also finding that it can be used for environmental and chemical sensors. So why isn't everything made of graphene right now? I mean, it's just carbon, there's plenty of carbon. It's really hard to make graphene. So there are a couple different methods right now. Mechanical exfoliation is what the first isolators used, what's now called the Scotch tape method. Mechanical exfoliation is the official name of that one. That is actually considered the gold standard for high quality monolayer graphene, but they're only able to make it in very small quantities. Like millimeter areas is considered large scale graphene production. And mechanically exfoliated graphene, gram for gram, is one of the most expensive materials on the planet right now. Chemical vapor deposition and epitaxial growth of graphene both involve depositing carbon on a substrate in a single monolayer. But those also have their drawbacks. So chemical vapor deposition, actually for both of them, you need to remove the graphene from the substrate to be able to use it. Chemical vapor deposition generally uses a copper substrate, but then it uses methane gas to remove it from the substrate. It also destroys the copper in the process, but it has all these toxic chemicals that they use. Both of them require a lot of specialized equipment, lots of energy to make any graphene at all. So my research has been focused on trying to make graphene via thermal decomposition with laser ablation. And what that actually means is, so we've taken just a commercially available polyimide film and exposed it to a laser beam. At UNC Asheville, we have a carbon dioxide laser. It's a student-built, continuous-wave gas laser. It uses a mixture of carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and helium, and that gives us an infrared beam. It lasers at 10.6 microns, which, just to give you sort of an idea, we end up with like 300 to 400 degrees Celsius peak temperatures with that. So what we've done is taken polyimide film. What we're using is called Captain. It's available through DuPont. It's a commercially available product. It's used in 3D printing. More specifically, if anyone got to see the James Webb telescope engineer speak last night, when they're talking about the sun shields for that, they're using Captain in that. It's inexpensive, it's super easy to get, and we're mounting it on a manual shutter, just placing it in the direct path of the beam. And we've exposed these from anywhere between 1 second to 1 minute, and we vary the temperature or the wattage between 3.5 and 5 watts. And here's what we found. So the best way to characterize graphene is through Raman spectroscopy. And so this is what we would expect to see for single layer graphene. As you guys, for anyone that's here, maybe heard earlier, Raman spectroscopy gives you a measure of the change in vibrational modes in a material. And so this is not my data, by the way. This is just a representative of what you look for single layer graphene and multi-layer graphene. And for most of the samples, we were getting this. So it's super noisy, except in right there where we would expect to see there. The peak for graphene, just nothing. So we did a little research and realized that the polyimide film that we're using has a photoluminescent effect right in this area with the 535 nanometer laser that we've been using. So we tried to do a couple other methods of analysis. This is our X-ray diffraction analysis. What we are looking at here, so X-ray diffraction looks at the crystal structure of a material by sending X-rays through and looking at how the electrons bounce off the different lattice planes. So the top is an unablated piece of polyimide, and the bottom is one of our samples. If we had made graphene, we would have expected to see a change in that. But as you can see, so again, we looked for one more method. This is an electron microscope image. Had we made it, we would have expected to see some graphite forms on this side or on this side, but again, nothing. Well, most recently, we continue to tweak the power and the time exposures of our samples because this has been done before, so we knew that this could happen. So just to give you sort of a reminder, this is what we'd be looking for if we had made graphene. And this was our most recent result. Thank you. But again, this is an unverified graphene signature. I've actually been working with Dr. Perkins' small research group, some of them are here right now, to use their Raman spectrometer and to try to analyze these samples. And so this is not, we're not sure, but we're cautiously optimistic that we may have made graphene. So in the future, what we really need to do is verify our results Ideally, what we'd like to do is use a tunable Raman laser to be able to negate the effects of the photoluminescence and see if we are actually finding graphene. And if we have, we'd like to see the effect of the heating rates on that, which, if you guys actually read my abstract, was the point of this. But making graphene is hard, as I have told you, so it has taken us a bit to get to positive graphene results. And then, ideally, we would be able to make larger areas of graphene. What I'm dealing with right now, the sample areas are just millimeters square, so still very, very small. So, in conclusion, thermal decomposition may be a really promising alternative. We can make samples very quickly, we can do that very efficiently, we really don't need any specialized equipment besides for that carbon dioxide laser, but really all that is, it's a heat source that's very intense and gives us a very quick burst of heat that we need for the thermal decomposition of the polyimide. And most importantly, it's scalable. Graphene research, like I said, is a billion-dollar industry right now. Everyone is trying to find ways to make graphene in larger quantities, high quality, monolayer graphene, and thermal decomposition might be the key for that. I would like to thank Dr. Bennett, my advisor here, and also Dr. Perkins from also the physics department, Dr. Brittany McNamee from the environmental sciences department. They both were instrumental in helping me analyze these samples. The entire UNC Asheville undergraduate research program and the Council on Undergraduate Research for hosting this conference. Thank you guys. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
You said you made some changes to the setup to get that beautiful graph that you showed us. Can you point to a particular thing that you think made
yeah.
that change happen?
So I think mostly it is the just the right ablation time and power meter and power reading to get graphene. Again, we're really cautious about that one. We're not sure if that is actually going to be graphene, but I mean, as you guys can see, this looks really good. But I've actually done a lot of modifications to our laser. Initially, in previous research, we were running it at a much higher power wattage. We were actually attempting to do epitaxial growth of graphene on silicon carbide. And so there was a lot of time spent modifying the laser itself. And so there's been a lot of tweaks to that to try to get the power exactly where I'm looking, what I'm looking for. Yes.
So you mentioned a couple times this is very exciting, but you're cautious about it. So
yes.
How will you verify it? What are you going to do now with this data to see?
So actually, Dr. Perkins is helping me get in touch with someone over at Western Carolina, where they have a Raman spectrometer that does have a tunable laser. And so we're hoping to be able to filter out the effects of photoluminescence. And that's really going to be the big one. Also, one of the things is that in Raman spectroscopy, you want to be able to subtract the effect of your substrate from the material that you're looking for. And this is essentially raw data. I mean, it's put into a very nice presentation, but we're not seeing any of the noise that we saw in this top one. And this was just polyimide. My hope is it's because we turned the polyimide into graphene. And so that is what we're seeing. But that's another factor that we're going to have to look at and see whether this actually was a positive result. Yeah?
Can you explain a little about the photoluminescence?
So a little bit, yes. Dr. Perkins is helping with this a lot. So basically what it means is that there's too much noise in there. And that I've actually tried reducing the power of the laser. I know that you had talked about that a little bit in yours, that you wanted more information. We had too much information in ours. So there's basically too many photons scattering around in there, and we overloaded the CCD right around 2700 wave numbers, which right where we were expecting for a graphene signature.
Oh, I see.
So it's sort of just a bad coincidence, but we were able, there are ways to get around that. It's just that the equipment that we have here doesn't have that capability.
Yes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Speakers today. What a wonderful session.
Yeah.
Enjoyed it. Enjoy the rest of the conference.